Now, with the looming end of the appointment ban on losing bets in the last elections, a lot of reports have surfaced about the next palace appointee from defeated candidates. One of them is former Bukidnon congressman Neric Acosta, who ran for the Senate under the Liberal Party's ticket and is said to take over as environment secretary. So, sir, are congratulations in order already?
Again, I'll take Secretary Coloma's line, Gigi. Until the palace, and especially, of course, the president makes that formal announcement one way or another, this is still a matter still of, should we say, speculation. But okay. I am really, I'd like to hasten to add, though, that in whatever capacity, that's been very clear, not only because we're officers and members of the Liberal Party and we've long worked together with the president and those of us in the Liberal Party on governance and environment, human rights, etc. We're ready to really serve this presidency and this president and the tuwid na daan. And so we're prepared, but the formality of it, I was even hesitating.
I'm not sure I understand why we're being coy here. I mean, why don't we just get on with it and admit it? I mean, I guess the question is DENR or Department of Agriculture? Which one is it? Which one were you promised?
Well, my trajectory is, and my advocacies have always been on the environment.
Environment. And so that's what you were promised. How did that work out? How did that?
You're good.
That was promised a long time
Well,
ago,
it was the understanding in the Liberal Party that since, as congressman, I was principal author of practically all the environmental laws in place on air, water, solid waste, biodiversity, that this was really sort of my comfort as well as my expertise zone. So yeah, that was the understanding that if in the event the new presidency would really be in need of that expertise and experience, here was someone in the party more than willing and able to take up the challenge.
What time is your meeting with the president tomorrow?
Well, the president is in fact going to be in our Liberal Party fellowship and meeting monthly, which we hold every first Monday of the month. But since he just arrived from Jakarta, he's expected any time now, so I'll be rushing there.
Oh, so you're going to see him immediately after this interview?
Yes.
So I don't know why you're being coy, but okay. Okay, when was the last time that you and the president spoke about this?
Well, we have social events, right? And it's not like you're wedging yourself into the palace and official functions one way or another. It's mostly like this for Liberal Party. More social, more relaxed settings.
And what about Secretary Pahe? He was in on it the whole time. He was aware.
Well, I think the understanding from day one, Gigi, is when you're an acting secretary and you're not a designate, it means simply that you have to care for the interim of whatever number of months or time frame for
a bench warmer.
Yes, in that sense. Although I don't want to use that word probably, because to be fair, you also have to do your best. Whatever you're called, an OIC or a caretaker, you still assume the functions of real bureaucratic, the bureaucracy, managing the bureaucracy.
Then we would assume also this is the case with Secretary Robredo, who's also there in an acting capacity, right? Okay, so we assume that you're going to get the portfolio. What do you think really is the biggest problem of the DENR?
Wow. Let us count
the
ways.
Single biggest problem.
I think the single biggest problem is the fact, maybe in the shorter term of the last 5 to 9 or 10 years, Gigi, is the fact that it's had the highest turnover of cabinet secretaries, of secretaries.
Okay.
So in the 9 years of the former president, there were 8 secretaries. That, of course, makes for not only difficulty or even some confusion in policy directions. It does make also for a real sense of being, for the rank and file, especially and in the regions, a difficulty of getting and consolidating certain programs and projects in place. And because of that, the environmental destruction and degradation, which is very high, one of the very highest in not only in Asia and the world, mm-hmm. for the Philippines. I mean, the kind of truly unsustainable practices we're seeing, pollution, mm-hmm. air, land, water, solid waste, etc., get severely compromised, mm-hmm. meaning the programs, you know, mm-hmm. they get further derailed. And we're seeing the impacts mm-hmm. and the effects on that GG. The fact that we live in a day and age of vulnerabilities mm-hmm. to climate change. Mm-hmm. You know? All of the ondoy, pepeng, the flooding, right. the droughts.
So what's the first thing you're going
to
do?
The first thing actually is to make sure that you have, if you're a driver, mm-hmm. You got to know where you're headed. Mm-hmm. And if you're a driver in a vehicle called whatever bureaucracy, you got to have a roadmap. Mm-hmm. And literally, we need a map. Mm-hmm. You need a honest to goodness 1:10,000 or even 1:5,000 map that shows all the geohazards, the protected areas, the rivers, the settlements, the seas, the coastal, the critical watersheds. Because how else will you know where you start, where are the priority areas, where to put money mm-hmm. so that you get more cost-effective programs and projects.
But it all sounds so hypothetical. No, I mean,
but it can be done. It, in fact, it's a matter of just consolidating. We have the NAMRIA, mm-hmm. the National Mapping Agency of Government. We have private sector, in fact, firms who have done a lot of the upgraded and state-of-the-art mapping. Mm-hmm. No? And it's a matter of putting them together. If we can't put them all for the whole country right away, there are ways where you do it region for region. And that alone is going to really help set clearer directions.
What's your position on mining? We had a big mining accident not too long ago, 2-3 weeks ago. Yeah. What's your take on mining?
Well, mining is remains one of the six major pillars or thrusts of economic or of policy of the state. So in and of itself, you have a mining act. You can't do away with that, mm-hmm. just like that. But my personal as well as, well, in the event, a professional and institutional position on that mm-hmm. is that you have to be very clear about where to regulate and how. Mm-hmm. Because it must be. It cannot continue wantonly. It can, if there are impacts, we must be very sure about those impacts. So to me, Gigi, there are three areas where you have to be very clear about. Like if you're in protected zones, key biodiversity areas, mm-hmm. watersheds, non-negotiable, yeah. If it's in violation of any of the clean air, clean water, biodiversity, or any mm-hmm. Of the environmental laws, no go rin. And then the third is equity. It's the acceptability of the communities. Because in the end, they have to feel and know and understand that they will benefit from it. Mm-hmm. That it's not just extraction, and that's not just about the revenues and the employment and the economic benefits. It's what they also, as communities, where these activities are going to be taken.
But again, easier said than done.
Absolutely.
Because it's also going to take a culture, you know,
yes.
a shift in the mindset of
yes.
people.
Yes. But in the first order of the day, of course, is enforcement, mm-hmm. right? And that's why it's the chief executive's call. And that's why he has all of these departments as extensions of the as president to make sure that laws are enforced. Mm-hmm. We have very clear environmental laws. Mm-hmm. However, we just have to make sure that we review very clearly, because it's not just like a mining act. You also have an Indigenous Peoples mm-hmm. Rights Act. You also
right.
have the local government
right.
code. You also have in the absence of a national land use, you have land use also ordinances and laws in specific areas. So there are overlaps, and
right.
you have to be very, there's agrarian reform.
And
too.
As is the case always with this country, there are good laws, but really the problem is in the implementation.
Right.
Now, when you're appointed, you're going to have to go through the Commission on Appointments. Are you expecting rough sailing through the Commission on Appointments?
Well, it can cut both ways, Gigi. On one hand, you can always be seen as a sort of part of a collegial, because as former congressman, perhaps they'll say, okay, we understand where this guy's coming from, we mm-hmm. know him, because you're dealing with senators and congressmen, mm-hmm. many of them who were colleagues, so they know your work.
Mm-hmm.
and advocacies and such. So my hope is that should be a plus. But however, it only takes one or two to oppose you. Mm-hmm. We know that for a fact. And it can also go that way.
Of course, there are at least two complaints against you that are pending at the Office of the Ombudsman, yes, stemming from the time when you were a congressman.
Yes.
How do you expect to deal with that? That's going to come out in the open,
of course, absolutely. In fact, it's coming out. I mean, whether it's used as black propaganda or part of a smear campaign, mm-hmm, it's been part of, this is more than a 10-year sort of stretch of issues, mm-hmm, that have actually led to this case. Mm-hmm. But the context of this GG is, first of all, it really came because I was, along with Congressman then, Noynoy Aquino, mm-hmm, we were endorsers of the impeachment of the former president. Mm-hmm. And in fact, I was also part of that impeachment of the former ombudsman. Mm-hmm. So the context there is you lost your pork barrel, I was kicked out of my being committee and ecology chair, mm-hmm, and then also this case. So I understand this is part of the territory. I have submitted myself to the process. Mm-hmm. As any public officer, we should be accountable at all times. Mm-hmm. You don't run away from accountability. Mm-hmm. So if this comes out in the confirmation process, you know, we're fair game. Mm-hmm. I mean, we're in the public arena, right? Mm-hmm. And we defend ourselves as best we can. But, you know, you just have faith that, you know, you'll get due process and justice will be served.
Of course, it's not just you. I mean, there are other allies of the president who also have complaints filed against them. Secretary De Lima has a complaint filed against her. Secretary Purvisima, I mean, MMDA Chairman Francis Tolentino. Yeah. I mean, there's really a number of allies, yes, of the president which have complaints filed against them.
Yes.
Now, earlier we were speaking with Secretary Coloma about the drop in the satisfaction ratings for this administration. Do you think that that's going to pull him down even further, having all these close allies and having all these complaints against them?
Well, you know, Gigi, from a more sinister standpoint, probably. We've been in politics long enough to understand that even the prosecutorial arm of government, some of the judicial processes, not all the time, but especially in the past, mm-hmm, recent past, could very well be used also as tools for political harassment or retaliatory, mm-hmm, moves against those who are in opposition. My understanding and my sense really is that it can cut both ways, and it's how you also handle what is being thrown at you, because in the end, truth comes out. And if these are also ways of pulling the president down, it behooves us also, those who have had attacks hurled against us or cases filed against us, to make sure also that the president is not affected by these, and that we're able to fight it out institutionally or through the judicial process, due process. So it's a matter simply of being able to really being able to shield the president well enough, mm-hmm, but also believe still that the wheels of justice are fine.